absolutely amazing. All right, let's do this WrestleMania Raw report, and I'm sure we'll have more memories as we move on here.
So as noted, I watched this WrestleMania in my living room surrounded by friends. First time probably since last year, I just got to sit back and enjoy a show, and I didn't take a single note, which probably helped my mood significantly.
How are you doing the report for the newsletter?
That is a question I have yet to answer. I may have to go back and watch this whole thing a second time. We'll see. I've done it because I did reports for New York and Miami and New Orleans, and the world continued to spin. So,
well, that's true. It did continue to spin.
We'll figure something out. All right. So it opened with the pre-show match that I don't know if I mentioned this. My friends actually wanted to come over and watch the pre-show, like all 2 hours. I was stunned.
Did they know it was on the pre-show? Did they know they were coming over the Andre the Giant Battle Royal?
They knew there were two matches, and as it turned out, it's a long story, but they didn't end up getting there until 3, so they only saw the two matches anyway. They missed the 1 hour of people flapping their gums. So it opened with a four-way tag match. Kid and Cesaro versus The New Day versus Los Matadors versus Usos. Everyone worked hard. Everyone looked good. It was a wild collection of spots, including the biggest one here. And I know, did Dave do the live report on the website?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Dave glossed over here. They did the Tower of Doom spot, which we've all seen 10,000 times. But usually when you do that, the guys in the middle, they're really taking a bump off the middle rope. And the guys at the bottom are just pretending to be involved and then just falling down randomly.
That's right.
They did the suplex here, and they had Big E and Cesaro, who are huge, enormous, powerful men. And they had two guys on their shoulders in a chicken fight position, and those two guys suplexed other people. That's six bodies all falling to earth in a very tight area. And the Matador, who I believe was on Big E's shoulders, he ended up falling essentially straight down on the back of his neck. This is the scariest bump in the entire show.
Mm.
On TV it was.
Mm. What was scarier, Craig? I can't think of anything.
Dean Ambrose going through the ladder.
Oh,
that was a strong number two.
That was pretty bad.
That was a pretty clear number
two. But hey,
two.
He wrestled the next day. I haven't seen the Matador since.
It's true.
That is true.
Actually, you saw him in the next match.
Oh, yeah. Came back off of the Battle Royale. So he survived.
I can't confirm that's the same guy.
Oh, the mask? It threw you off?
Yes.
Yeah.
Could have been anybody.
Go ahead, Vinny.
Hey, Vinny, you know who quit?
I heard CJ Parker quit.
Your boy CJ Parker quit.
Darn.
I have no hard feelings.
I can't imagine why. His career was on the upswing.
Yes. Hey. Yeah. No, I wish him well in whatever he does next.
He's just been future endeavored by Vince Fairhigh.
Yeah. I mean it, though. They're dicks when they say it. They're insincere.
From
the bottom of my heart. I hope CJ Parker, whatever his real name is, I hope his next career brings him happiness and joy and money.
What a nice guy.
I don't think he was getting any of that in Orlando.
Clearly not. He quit.
Touche. So after a bunch of craziness here, and Uso hit a splash and Cesaro stole the pin, so they were still the tag champs.
I thought this match was awesome.
Nice review.
Yeah, nothing. I've reviewed the show 10 times so far.
Natty putting the bull in the sharpshooter on the outside was...
Actually, that reminds
very
me.
Very comical.
Why the fuck has Cesaro not swung this bull yet?
It's not time, Brian.
How many years do I have to wait to see this?
It's not a feat of strength.
This is like the build-up for Goldust and Stardust. It took 2.5 years, and then it was bullshit, so to speak.
See what you did there?
I need to see this spin.
Mm-hmm.
I got nothing more to add.
I had a great idea just now.
Go ahead.
When Cesaro finally does the spin to the bull, he needs to spin him 30, 40, 50 reps. And then when he lets him go, the bull is now 6 feet tall. Even stretched out.
It's not a bad idea.
It's a great one.
Or maybe you can just pick him up, put him on his index finger, and spin him like a basketball.
How have they not figured out how to get Cesaro over yet?
See, he's tiny.
I mean, if I ran this company,
he's a midget, you know.
I could have Cesaro come out and spin the bull, and he'd be over. Or I could bring him out on Raw and have him grab anybody and have him spin that man 100 times, and he'd be over for the rest of his career. How have they not figured this out yet?
He's already done it on YouTube, you know.
100 times?
Grizzly Redwood.
Oh, that doesn't count.
I know.
Who may be smaller than Torito.
It's true.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Grizzly, but this needs to be done in WWE to get him over in WWE. He was already over in Ring of Honor.
I understand.
That's not the issue.
It was Chikara, but who's counting?
Go on, Vinny.
We had the Andre the Giant Battle Royal. I still don't know how many men were in this.
30.
They did find 30 warm bodies.
Yes, they did.
Impressive. All I know, all I got out of this is that I have no idea why they even bothered putting Hideo Itami in there.
Because they were inducting a Japanese fella, Tatsumi Fujinami, into the Hall of Fame, and thus there was a lot of press coming to America because there are easy flights from Japan to the West Coast.
So they wanted to embarrass this Japanese person in front of the Japanese media?
Well, the idea was that he would get over big by winning and ending up in the Battle Royal, thus getting the rub by being beaten on by the Big Show.
It didn't work. He looked like the biggest geek of them all.
He got punched in the face and fell on the ground.
Yep. It was no good. So, as we all know...
Oh, I didn't get Dave's cough.
You're going to have it for 2 months.
It came down to the Miz's and Big Show. And the Miz's had a conversation for 7-8 minutes about what to do next. Mizdow eventually threw Miz out. They got Mizdow versus Big Show for a while. And I was thinking during this, they were pushing how Big Show's never won a Battle Royal. And I thought about how often he has been a runner-up. Off the top of my head, he was a runner-up in last year's Andre the Giant Battle Royal. He was the runner-up when Chris Benoit won the Royal Rumble. He was the runner-up when The Rock won the Royal Rumble. I was thinking, before they even brought it up, how often he doesn't win these things. And then he just won this one. Because I guess it's time for a new face on top?
And with all
oh, yeah. Man, and what a follow-up they did on Raw with the Big Show.
They
trot out Damian Mizdow, and nobody gives two shits about the guy. He's already dead.
Yeah, the wrong man won here.
I don't even know if, honest to God, I don't even know if Mizdow would have been the right man to win. But
there were no right men in this match.
Itami?
Yeah.
I guess, yeah. He would have been the rightest one.
This was a better battle royal than usual, I will say that. Again.
Yeah, they took time to get out of the way and do some spots in the middle. Had Itami throwing kicks against Tyson Kidd, and there was some
He
was
did
some
get
good
to
action.
Do the Kenta strike sequence right before they threw him out.
Yeah.
So there's that. But maybe my memory is faulty, but my memory is that last year's Battle Royal was better. Had the ladder match for the IC title. It was Daniel Bryan, R-Truth, Dolph Ziggler, Wade Barrett, who was ripped to shreds. Luke Harper, Stardust in his Mr. Sinister costume, and Dean Ambrose.
Guess who didn't win?
I give you 6 guesses.
R-Truth.
Truth didn't win.
I was pulling for him.
The winner at the end was the guy we all thought it would be. This was, in fact, the single biggest bump in the show happened here when, it's this is the Matador. But they set up a ladder bridge, actually for a long time before Dean finally went through it. And then Dean went through it. And I don't know how clear this was to you guys live, but, you know, going through a ladder is bad enough. But he went through this ladder, and the way the ladder folded under him, he ended up essentially on the back of his head with his torso pointing straight up in the air.
Yeah.
Very bad for you.
Looked ugly.
Yeah, this was no good. Don't do this. Although, to be fair, I thought Daniel Bryan would kill himself in this match. And he was fine. He did not kill himself at all. He did a diving headbutt, but in general, everybody tempered themselves, except for Dean Ambrose.
And I will say this, it was stupid. I don't recommend going through ladders. But he went through a ladder in the biggest show of the year, and then he was never seen again. So it meant something.
That's right. And then it meant nothing the next day when he just showed up and wrestled John Cena.
That is correct. But it meant something for a while. When people go back and watch this Mania in 10 years, they will note Dean Ambrose took a giant bump through a ladder, and it was a spot that took him out of the match, which is much better for him than going through a ladder and being back on his feet in 2 minutes.
This was the first time that the crowd absolutely wet themselves on this show. As planned and as predicted, good to see Daniel Bryan win the title.
Yeah. So Wade started bullhammering the hell out of everyone. It was a great spot where he just grab guys out of the air and bullhammer them and then turn around and bullhammer some other guy. It was really awesome. And it came down to Bryan and Ziggler on top of the ladder, and they began to exchange no hands headbutts, just wailing on each other like goats. And the crowd was going nuts, and finally Dolph took the big bump, and Bryan grabbed the belt and won. Very, very good opener.
Dolph should have known better than to have a headbutt battle with the goat face.
Yeah.
I stole Craig's joke. I knew he was thinking about it.
Thank you for reading my mind.
You're welcome.
What's it thinking now?
I can't say. Go on, Vinny.
Randy Orton versus Seth Rollins.
You suck.
Huh?
That's what was on Craig's mind.
I see.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're close.
So I actually listened to your show with Dave last night or yesterday whenever it aired, but I must echo his line here. If you watch this and you think, boy, Randy Orton and Seth Rollins are excellent professional wrestlers.
Yes, they are.
This is not a great match. It was a very, very good match. It was a 3 to 3.5 star match. But everything they did was done exceptionally well.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And the finish, as noted, was an all-time great finish.
I think that Randy Orton knew, if we pulled this fucking move off, this is a match I'm going to want to show people for the rest of my life. So I'm going to work my goddamn ass off the whole time. I think that's what happened. You have never seen a man so excited as Randy. I don't think Randy Orton has won world titles and celebrated like
he did
when they pulled off this curb stomp into an RKO.
As I'm sure you all know, the finish was after they both kicked out of each other's move, Rollins tried a curb stomp, but instead of planting Orton's face into the mat, he launched himself essentially off of Orton's back, and Orton launched him high into the air and caught up with an RKO coming down. And he did not make the cover right away because, yes, he marked out for them.
Yes.
For himself and for Seth for pulling this off. He was so happy.
And rightfully happy.
It was awesome.
It was great. Yeah. I am not a fella who marks out during shows, but man, I leaped 10 feet in the air. I had to be caught by Tara sitting next to us. Let me tell you about this lady.
She was amazing.
You have never, ever...
We didn't tell who was sitting with us.
I just did. Tara.
Victoria,
yes.
Lisa Marie Verone. Yes.
You have never in your life seen a bigger wrestling fan.
And she's an ex-wrestler.
Oh, yeah.
Blows my mind.
You've never... I mean, can you imagine Buddy Wayne in the crowd at WrestleMania? That was not Lisa Marie Verone. Holy shit.
Are you allowed to chew in WrestleMania?
She was jumping up and down. She was dancing.
Hitting Craig in the shoulder.
Every time there was a big spot, she would either hit Craig or grab me or leap in the air or whatever. She had to have the time of her life.
She was...
Drank about 4 beers.
Grooving to the
correctly.
Music the whole time. Buying people things. It was...
Oh, yeah. Every time she left her chair. Anybody want anything?
Yeah.
And people would ask for things. And then she would come back with it.
Yes.
That's astounding.
She came back with... garlic fries and regular fries and a thing of chicken fingers.
Yeah.
And just passed them off.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, she just had the time of her life at this show.
Amazing lady.
Yeah.
They showed Ronda Rousey in the front row.
I saw her show up.
She walked right in front of us.
Yeah.
It seemed like your usual WrestleMania, look, we have celebrities here moment.
Yes.
It was, in fact, great foreshadowing.
You know what Ronda Rousey is?
Hot.
Hot.
Mm.
Super hot.
She's much hotter in person than she is on television. I can say that.
The other three horsewomen, excuse me.
Must we, Craig?
They were at the WrestleCon show.
There as well.
Yeah, they were there as well.
Sting versus Triple H. Hunter came out in his...
How was this on television, Vinny?
We dubbed it wacky. There's a very fine line between cool and wacky.
I heard the commentary was shit.
Shocking.
Throughout the show, I mean, this one, it really bothered people because JBL was burying Sting in WCW and saying now he's in the major leagues or whatever the hell he said. I thought on the whole, the crew had a better than average night for their very low standards.
Wow.
They're still terrible.
Go back and watch it with the sound off because this match was phenomenal.
This was the best match live.
It was
dude
awesome.
This match ruled on TV.
Okay.
It was Well, I'll finish with the commentary. My buddy Greg has not watched a show since the last time he watched a show with me, which was probably at least a decade. And he was trying to figure out the commentary because the roles each commentator played made no sense to him. He was trying to figure out who was the heel. He was trying to figure out who was the play-by-play guy. And I just said, Greg, they're all just idiots. And it changes from match to match. So try not to worry about it. But here, yes, it didn't bother me as much as it bothered everyone else. But JBL was burying essentially the match by burying Sting so deeply. And it probably helped that I had friends in there. We were all talking over him anyway. But so this match was, yes, tons and tons and tons of fun.
Mm-hmm.
It started off as two guys who probably had 20,000 matches in their careers who are now, you know, this is the perfect spot on the show for this match. Because these guys, and they know it and we know it, they're on their way down. Sting's case.
Except for Hunter's weight. It's on its way up. Holy shit, that guy was gigantic.
He was large.
He was bigger than that palm tree that we saw in Orlando a couple of years
Might
ago.
Been.
Holy shit. I needed to get a new seat whenever he was in the corner in front of me.
So they had a veteran pro wrestling match.
Yes.
And if you watch what they did, they actually did very, very little, but got maximum reaction out of it.
Oh, I saw it.
Did you happen to see how Hunter got the huge bruise on his...
No, we were trying to figure it out.
Yeah, we couldn't figure it out either.
We thought at first, once we realized that his whole leg was red...
And purple and red and green.
Yeah, we thought it was actually a pre-existing injury that he entered the match with it.
Because
there's nothing obvious to where it might have happened. Sting had one under his arm, but you can just get that from running on the ropes if you've done it in a while.
We thought initially that he had torn something.
So do we.
Okay.
See, that does not look like a bruise. That looks like a severe internal injury of some kind. So, as far as I heard, it wasn't, and he never looked. Aside from turning purple on his left thigh and hamstring, he didn't appear to be injured at all. So they're having a very basic but fun match, and Sting goes to take the Scorpion, and out comes D-Generation X.
That's right.
In the form of X-Pac, Billy Gunn, and Road Dogg. And there's all kinds of interference, and Sting fights them off for a while, but he's finally overwhelmed, and it looks like Hunter's going to kill him. And what should play but the NWO music? Now, a couple things. First of all, this, of course, makes no sense. Sting hated the NWO.
Right.
His whole purpose in WCW is to stop the NWO from killing the company, and he ultimately failed.
I was expecting that the NWO Red and Black would come out instead.
Exactly.
Yeah, that would have at least made a little bit more sense.
Who would have been in that?
Virgil.
Okay.
Scott Norton.
I don't think Conan was coming in.
Probably not. I don't want to nitpick this match because I loved it so much, but I do have to say that it was weird to watch the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
And Hunter's out there and the clique is reunited and they're all hugging. And then this happened.
So, yes. Logically, there was a great logic disconnect here where these guys, it made no sense these guys would help Sting. Now, on top of that, there's a term in wrestling for when someone comes in from the back to interfere in a match. And in wrestling terminology, that is known as a run-in.
Right.
This was a saunter-in. Because it's Hulk Hogan and Scott Hall and Kevin Nash in 2015. And if you think I'm old, I'm doing much better physically than these men are. They took a long time walking down that great big aisle. They started a brawl. You guys were live, maybe you saw this, but you must go back and watch the replay. X-Pac's selling and bumping for Hulk Hogan's punches. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. So they do the giant brawl, and if the first two scariest spots in the show were the Matador falling on his head and Dean Ambrose going through the ladder, the third scariest spot was everything these old men did.
Yes.
Hulk Hogan got posted.
Yeah.
He fell down.
Scott Hall took a backdrop on the floor.
Scott Hall took a backdrop on the floor. Kevin Nash took some sort of bump and grabbed his quad.
Yeah. I don't even see what happened. I saw him on the ground grabbing his knee. I thought, oh, fuck, he tore both quads again.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow everyone survived. In the midst of all this chaos and insanity, Shawn Michaels also appeared, and he interfered. Sting fought off that interference. And
no,
he
got super kicked.
Well, he got super kicked, but he kicked out and made his comeback.
Yes.
So, Finally, he's going for a stinger splash, but Hunter catches him with the head of the sledgehammer and is finally able to pin the man. And then after all this, after 15 years of WWE versus WCW, after the NWO versus DX brawl we've been waiting 15 years to see, and after Hunter hit Sting in the head with a sledgehammer, they had a respectful handshake.
Yeah.
This made zero sense from start to finish, and I don't care. It was tremendous fun.
Well, yeah. That was the one thing. I mean, I allowed the craziness of NWO versus DX, even though I saw the click all happy at the Hall of Fame. But when Sting shook his hand, and I just thought, hey, dumb shit. He's hit you in the head with a sledgehammer. He blatantly cheated and had all of his friends run in to beat your ass. Why are you shaking his hand? But he did.
Maybe he wasn't fully recovered from the sledgehammer shot yet. Perhaps he thought it was Nick Bockwinkel or something.
I actually, honest to God, thought that they would bring out Nick Patrick in this match.
They should have, actually.
I really did. I thought that Charles Robinson would get bumped and fucking Nick Patrick would run his ass out there. And fuck something up.
I actually thought until the brawl started that at some point here, X-Pac was going to strip off his NWO shirt and reveal a DX shirt and help Sting win. Or help, yeah.
I could have done that. I can't imagine X-Pac being involved in the finish, however. But it would have been a nice little swerve.
Yeah.
You know what's funny is because of the Hall of Fame, when the NWO and the DX started brawling, at first I thought the NWO all turned on each other.
Yeah,
I was completely confused as about who was on whose side. This was a lot of fun, though.
Tons of fun.
Tremendous fun.
How could anyone have thought this was bad on television? I guess I got to watch it.
This touched so many older folks, you know, our age. This was the prime.
If you were around for the Monday Night Wars,
yeah,
this is something that you saw in your head 1,000 times, and here we finally got it for real.
Yeah, it was awesome.
I never saw this in my head once, but I'll take your word for it.
Had a wacky skit backstage where great Intercontinental Champions of the past all talked about how awesome Daniel Bryan was. And Roddy Piper and
Flair shot on Steamboat.
Ric Flair chopped Rick Steamboat.
Cackled.
Ric Flair was tremendous here. Like, even by his own high standards, Ric Flair was tremendous. And then Ron Simmons came in and said, damn. And everyone just kept saying, yes, yes, yes.
You know, let me say something about Flair. When he came out for the Hall of Fame to introduce Tatsumi Fujinami, and I'd been seeing people like Rikishi talk for 30 minutes earlier in the show, and Ric Flair got 3 minutes, I thought, I know you guys don't trust this guy in the mic, but really? 3 minutes for Ric Flair? When he went out of his mind, apeshit crazy, and shot on Ricky Steamboat and was completely out of his mind, I was like, yeah, 3 minutes was about as much as you probably should have given that guy last night. It could have gotten bad.
He was signing at the WrestleCon hotel on Saturday. We were in there having breakfast with, no lie, the Dudleys and Chris Masters. I know. And there's Ric Flair across the hall signing for $100 apiece. And I had to physically restrain Matt not to run and give him his money.
Oh, why didn't you let him?
Craig.
It's not like it was Rey Mysterio asking for $350.
Are you kidding me?
Oh, yeah.
For an autograph?
Oh, yeah. Mm. He'd sign 5 things for $350.
Oh.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm mostly kidding, but Matt's like, this is the only guy I would give money to in this place.
Wow. I did show up at the hotel on whatever night it was, and Chris Masters was checking in as well. Yeah. I stayed so far away from that WrestleCon stuff, I was just afraid.
It was very surreal walking around.
I didn't even know it was at the hotel.
And there would be wrestlers that you've grown up watching just doing their thing, but you're not allowed to approach them unless you have $20 bills in your hand.
Yeah, no,
it's just, it was very weird.
I just, I thought the WrestleCon hotel was just like WrestleCon had made a hotel deal. And so if you were going to go to WrestleCon, this was the hotel that you could stay at. Right. I was unaware that everything was happening at the hotel that I was at.
Including the matches.
Yeah, I was pissed off on Saturday night because everybody was pretty much done Saturday night. And so, like, I was so tired on Saturday night. And I get home and just people are lining the halls. They're yelling. They're just loud.
Yeah.
It was like, can't you just go in your room?
It was
this hall is not that attractive.
It was a nonstop party. It smelled of skunk all 3 days we were there.
Yeah. I was in a different wing, apparently. I didn't smell it, but...
Well.
I did see a interesting hookup.
As did I.
Go on, Vinny.
Yeah.
Wait a minute.
We don't have any names. It was just interesting. I was unaware that there
were...
What
was interesting about it?
Well, it was Santa Clara and not Las Vegas. And there were women of the night all over the place.
I understand now.
Matt and I actually saw a transaction take place. Guy pulled up in a Camaro. A girl. She was not a McDonald's employee. Got in the car. They left. We thought, that's kind of weird. Got our fast food. Pulled out. Camaro drove by us again. And then pulled into the $88 a night hotel next to the McDonald's.
Man.
You do the math.
Big Macs are delicious.
$88.
What rhymes? Never mind. Go on, Vinny. Quickly.
Bella Twins versus AJ Lee and Paige.
Oh, what a coincidence.
What's coincidental about it?
Well.
What does that have to do with what we were just talking about?
We're talking about hookers.
Where are you, Vinny? Where were you on Monday night when we were talking about these chants against the ladies and sucks and $88? Come on. Put it all together.
So you're saying the Bella Twins are prostitutes?
No! I'm just saying that people were accusing them of illicit behavior on Raw Monday night.
I see.
It's not illicit if you love somebody.
It's really not if you're husband and wife. It's entirely different than...
Yeah, it's expected.
Well, according to these fans, it's illicit behavior. It's unacceptable illicit behavior.
So, anyway, there was a wrestling match to discuss here between the Bella Twins and AJ Lee and Paige.
Yeah.
I heard live this was okay.
Yeah.
It's all right.
This is a mess on TV. First of all...
It's probably a mess live. I honest to God, I don't remember anything about this match.
I don't either.
About a minute in, I missed, I don't know, less than a minute. I was pouring a drink, but I turned around, and AJ Lee is on the floor of the arena unconscious. Not moving. I thought she'd been shot. And like 3 minutes go by, she's not selling, she's not grabbing her wrist or her leg or her knee. She's on the ground, gone. And so Paige is going one-on-two for a while, and a few minutes go by, and suddenly AJ's in the ring running wild. What the hell happened? And they're all four chicks doing stuff for a while, and eventually the good girls won. I forget even how.
I don't remember. I swear to God, I can't remember a thing about this match right now.
AJ made Nikki submit to the Black Widow. Thank goodness Dave was here to write this down.
Oh, yeah. I must have been talking to you because I don't remember it either.
I do remember that Nikki lost because it was the let's have a bunch of title matches to lead to a tag match, and the tag match is going to set up title matches that we already saw.
Yes.
Get out of here. Next.
All the Hall of Fame induction folks came out for the big ovation. It was quite nice. Rusev versus Cena for the U.S. title.
You should have seen. I didn't go to the Hall of Fame. I watched it at Dave's. Just imagine this. Me, Dave Meltzer, and Court Bauer watching the Hall of Fame over Dave's shoulder on his computer upstairs. And if you've ever seen the picture of Dave's upstairs, it was in the New York Times. It's worse now. That's how I watched the Hall of Fame.
Why?
And you know that whenever there was a factual inaccuracy.
Oh, God.
Jeez.
That's right. I wouldn't have traded it for the world. It was an amazing experience.
So Rusev had one of the great entrances of Mania history.
This is why you should have regretted not going.
Awesome.
He came out on a fucking tank.
Yeah.
That's the end. You're skipping all the other stuff to lead up to the tank. The tank was the main event.
Lana
is a good start. He had a whole platoon of Russian troops marching out to the ring. They had the giant Russian flag they're carrying over their heads. They had, I believe, Michael Cole's exact line was, looks like cannons or something.
Fucking idiot.
They were, in fact, cannons. They were shooting off pyro.
It's blue snot all over my microphone because of Michael Cole.
Then finally,
wait
till
I tell you how much people loved when he was killed.
Rusev came out essentially surfing atop a tank. Outstanding entrance.
It was great.
It was great.
Did you hear my idea that I thought the finish was going to be?
Involved shoes.
Yeah. Lana comes out and she's got a white feather boa and she's all dressed up like...
I think it was fur.
Whatever it was. But the point is it was white. So at one point, Rusev puts Cena in the accolade and she distracts the ref. I don't even know why, to this day, thinking back on it, I have no idea why she threw a shoe into the ring, but she did.
Nothing.
Then she took off her other shoe. And so I thought, okay, well, they're going to do the accolade and she'll throw in her second shoe. And then she's going to be out of shoes. So the third time, the only thing she's got is that white thing around her neck and she's going to throw it in and it'll be a thrown in the white towel finish and he'll be fucked and you set up a rematch. Right? That's not what they did.
No.
Thank God.
What they did was...
Oh, like this finish was so much better. One FU and he won.
They were doing this match and Cena got out of the accolade and he hit an AA and he won, yes.
Yeah, there was not even one AA kick out.
No.
All that time he was undefeated. Well, one AA, that was his kryptonite.
Lana had to take off her shoes because she, in fact, had to take a bump off the ring apron.
Well, that did happen.
If you're wearing a heel, as I am told, taking a bump off the ring apron in heels is probably not a good idea.
Craig, can I just say something?
Absolutely.
Do you remember the Demon Kane?
Do I?
Do you remember when he had a mask on?
Sure.
Do you remember when he was unmasked?
Yeah.
Do you remember how for about 3 years, he actually shaved only the front part of his head?
Right.
So that he would have a fake bald spot on the top of his head.
Right.
And when you think about all of the fucking storylines that they don't pay any attention to or care one bit about, mm-hmm. including in main events, the fact that these fuckers went to this trouble to shave his head halfway back for every show for about 3 years blew my mind. Would it have been that big a deal if she just took her shoes off and jumped up on the apron? Would the wrestling world have been in a tizzy because there was no reason for her to be barefoot at that moment?
Why was
she
barefoot?
They had to come up with some fucking angle to get her shoes off. Of all the things on this show, that's what they cared about. Goldust won at the last fucking pay-per-view, and he couldn't even get on WrestleMania. And they have to find a storyline to get Lana's shoes off? Fuck that! I apologize, everybody.
Yelling at me or in general?
I just got a lot of... I'm tired.
We have devoted way too much energy to this match.
Sure.
It was a fine, adequate pay-per-view encounter.
It's good.
Great entrance.
Love
we mentioned that entrance?
Let's,
it was great.
Let's talk about it again. Go on, Vinny.
We had the best angle in the history of planet Earth. Hunter and Steph came out, gloating about the huge crowd they had drawn to this massive building, gloating about all they had... accomplished on the show, beating their hated enemy Sting, gloating about how they were the reason all the fans were there and how they owned the fans. And out came Dwayne Johnson.
The Rock, everybody.
Yeah. He came out to defend the fans, stand up for them. And he tore into them for a while. Actually, I'm cutting ahead of myself. First, he stood there for a long, long time as the crowd chanted his name over and over and over again. Rock is so good at milking a crowd. I know, breaking news.
The segment ran 10 minutes long, for those of you wondering.
And watching it live, they could have gone 10 minutes more. Easy. So, actually, that explains a lot. But
yeah, the main event, I think, was supposed to be 10 minutes longer, and they cut 10 minutes off of it, which, thank God.
I think that's much better.
For everybody's sake. Yeah. Us and the two guys beating the shit out of each other.
Yes. Yes. So eventually Rock speaks, and of course he buries them deep beneath the earth. And then Stephanie does what she has been doing for months, maybe a year now, where she steps up to emasculate and humiliate the wrestler. Stephanie's tremendous in this role, of course. She cuts him down, belittles him, mocks him, shames him, finally orders him to leave the ring. And Rock thinks about what she has to say, and he... takes a step back and he takes a step to the ropes.
He could never hit a woman.
She said that, yes, he could never hit a woman. And Rock ponders these words, realizes that, you know what, he can't hit a woman. So there's nothing to be done here but to make his exit. And the crowd, of course, knew something was going to happen. So they did not boo him as soon as he left. But he steps out of the ring towards the ramp, and he begins to circle over to the side. Now, a key point here, at the end of the Cena match, this is actually incredibly subtle, but it made so much sense. Cena went over to hug a woman in the crowd, who I later learned was Arnold Skolden's wife. Sitting next to her, not mentioned on TV, Rock's mom. So I thought at first Rock was going over to say hi to his mom, or bring his mom into the ring to hit Steph.
That would have been awesome, actually.
It would have been great. So as we all know by now, that didn't happen. In fact, something even better happened. And here's one where this was a moment where, unless you were watching the big screen, what happened on TV was in fact better than being there live, because there's chance of Rousey's name, but you didn't even really put two and two together that Rock was next to her. You thought fans were, doing whatever. And Rock goes over and he stands in front of her, but the camera's not showing her. The camera's showing him and a little bit of the ring. And then Rock turns to look at her, and as he turns, the camera pans with him, and then we see Ronda is right there. This was phenomenal television. Just a great shot. So Rock brings Ronda in, and then Rock was the Paul Heyman to Ronda Rousey's Brock Lesnar, which is awesome. Talks about all the horrible things she's going to do to Steph. Jump rope with the fallopian tubes. Ronda said virtually nothing except standing there looking mean with her "I'm going to kill you" face. And Steph was having none of this. She said, "You're the best in the octagon, but this is my ring and I'm in charge here." And Ronda simply said, "Wherever I am, it's my ring. And if you want me to leave, make me." Place went absolute batshit. And of course, it ended up with Rock and Hunter brawling. Hunter took a judo throw that was actually what a pro wrestling hip toss is supposed to look like. Mm-hmm. And that was awesome. And Steph went to slap Ronda, and Ronda trapped her arm and then just kind of let her go, because obviously you can't do the armbar spot yet because they're doing something in Dallas. And that was that. And Rock and Ronda left together. And
I like Rock and Randa. That should be their team name.
I think I said Ronda.
But Rock and Randa.
Yeah. But this was great. This was great, great, great stuff.
Rowdy Rocky Ronda.
This was great. Everybody in the building knew Ronda Rousey. There was not one person there that was like, "Who's that blonde?" Everybody knew that was Ronda, and shit was going down. Ronda is just like Brock. You know that shit's going down. That is a benefit to these UFC people coming in. You just know that trouble's coming whenever you see them. And it was coming.
This was so great because it was so totally unexpected.
I was not expecting this angle.
I did not think this was going to happen. No part of me thought this was going to happen going in.
And for the 9,000 people asking, no, I don't think Dave had any idea either.
Yeah, it was like, wow, this is really happening right in front of my eyes. This is awesome. I'm seeing it through the eyes of, when I was a kid, when I wasn't quote unquote smart, and I'm still pretty dumb, don't get me wrong. But it made me a fan again.
Wow.
I got on the bus.
That was very deep.
I got on the bus after the show, and the first thing I said when I get on the bus was,
"Where the fuck's Ed?"
Well, that
don't
was,
even get me started.
That was the second.
Do not even get me started with
that's
that.
The second
story.
Thing I said, but the first thing I said was, "I love wrestling again."
Wow!
Because this show—if
only you'd gotten a
Raw—was so amazing.
It was actually great, and Raw was awesome too till that last hour. But we'll get to that.
Yeah, go ahead, Vinny.
Craig, he touched on this, but this is one of those moments where I could not look away from the screen, and my buddies were trying to ask me questions, and I was shushing them.
Shut up.
Yeah, I want to watch what's going on.
Quiet.
I'll tell you what I know afterwards, but let me watch this right now.
Man, I wish I would have been in that living room for that.
All right. It was just like I just described.
I know. I've seen you in action.
I see. Undertaker versus Bray Wyatt.
And you'd been drinking.
A little. I was not. Anyway. Bray Wyatt came out with an army of scarecrows. That was cool.
Zombie scarecrows.
I didn't like it.
What did you not like about it?
Well, I liked it, but I thought it would be really cool. The zombies all walked down to the ring with him. And I thought it would be cool if they would have just had the scarecrows out there not moving, so you didn't know they were people, And then as the music's playing and he's walking through them, they just start to sway and dance
in place.
I was hoping
they would burst into flames when he walked by.
I'm not sure about that, but...
A bad idea considering they were people.
Yeah.
Well, there's that.
Other than that, it was good.
What your best idea for an entrance ever was, Brian?
I don't remember.
The first Shawn Taker match at Mania, they did an angle where a bunch of druids in white came out, and Shawn came out also in the Undertaker's costume, but in white.
Yes.
And then he cut his promo, and the finish was they played his music and he started dancing, and he muttered, "The druid should have been dancing too."
Sure.
That would have been awesome.
That probably would have been.
Anyway. Taker looked much better than he did last year. They had a, you know.
Can I say something about that?
2¾ star match. Go ahead.
Everybody. Brock Lesnar got a concussion about 2 minutes into the match last year.
Taker did.
Taker did.
Yeah.
I've been hearing for a year how Undertaker is finished, how he looked so bad in that match, and it's all over. You get a fucking concussion and then wrestle for 20 more minutes with Brock Lesnar, you tell me how good that match is. He had a concussion 2 minutes into the match.
Yeah.
He's fine. Yeah, he looked good here.
The big spot,
all things considered, being dead and all,
was when Bray had him down. They're doing a double down, in fact, and Bray busted out the crab walk and went over to scare Taker with it, but Taker sat up, and then Bray was scared.
Mm.
But he does not know what to make of all this nonsense.
But they cheered like crazy.
It was pretty awesome.
They went nuts for that spot.
So easy.
And Taker kicked out of one Sister Abigail and eventually won with a tombstone. And, you know, it was a match.
Mm-hmm. There we go, everybody.
It was a match.
It was a match. At WrestleMania.
And the only thing I got out of it was that Undertaker and Sting both have the same haircut now with the hole in the top.
Yeah.
Man.
It is 2015. Did you see that they were, in fact, photographed at the airport together?
Did not.
Yeah. Oh, I did hear that. Yeah. I didn't see the picture yet, though.
It's real estate Steve and his buddy Mark at the airport. It's not terribly exciting, but they were talking. And the main event, Brock Lesnar versus Roman Reigns for the championship. God damn, this is great.
Show was.
This was great. They did basically Lesnar versus Cena from SummerSlam with Brock beating him and beating him and beating him. And Roman was laughing it off, saying, "Bring it on. Hit me again. Is that all you got? You hit like a girl." So Brock hit him again. And I've heard many people say that wrestling Brock Lesnar is essentially being in a car wreck. And Brock's going to beat the hell out of you. He's going to demand that when he gives you offense, you beat the hell out of him. And if not, he's just going to hit you harder. So Roman was unloading him. Brock, and even on Raw, Brock looked worse on Raw than he did after most of his UFC fights. He got the crap beaten out of him. Roman got beat up worse. So there were at least 10 suplexes in this match. Belly to bellies, belly to backs, just a plain old vertical suplex, a belly to belly over the ropes, just threw them all around. It led to the line, which I actually missed live, but Brock screened at him, "Suplex City, bitch."
Oh, yeah.
Which got ridiculously over.
I wonder why.
Yeah. So, finally, they go outside. I'm going to assume someone made a drop already.
There's a couple songs already. Yeah.
Take me down with the Suplex City, bitch. There you go. Short and simple.
There you go. So finally they go outside and was that after Roman kicked out of the F5? Brock hit an F5 about a minute in, but chose to keep beating him up. He had a second F5. Roman kicked out of that, and that just pissed Brock off. So he tosses Roman out of the ring, and he goes to throw him into the post, but Roman reverses it. Brock hits the post and comes up bleeding like we haven't seen before. Bleeding all over the place. Deep gash right down the middle of his forehead. And he's woozy. He's on wobbly legs. Everyone in the stadium realizes, whether you like Roman or not, this is his one chance. He has to make this pay off. And he starts bombing Brock with Superman punches. Three or four of them, and Brock is wobbly and wobbly and wobbly. And he goes, he went for the spear, but Brock cut him off, hit an F5 of death. And now they are both down. And then Seth Rollins' music played. And Seth ran out. I think he curb stomped Brock once, tossed Roman out of the ring, went for another one on Brock, but Brock got him in an F5. But as he was carrying Seth around, Brock turned around, Roman speared Brock. Seth threw Brock out of the ring and curb stomped Roman to pin him and win the world championship. It was an absolutely great moment. It was on the very short list of great WrestleMania moments of all time, this title win. And I understand fans in the building went absolutely ballistic.
Yes, they did. Because Reigns didn't win.
Well, that helped.
That was the main thing.
Yes.
Everybody loved Brock like they loved Santa Claus. But a cash-in surprise was a perfect ending booking-wise, but it was very, very acceptable to all these fans in the building.
I can only tell you what would happen to the four guys in my living room. But there's a fine line between leaving the fans wanting more and leaving them unsatisfied, and they thought this was anticlimactic. They didn't get a finish to the fight they were watching. You got a third guy coming in and fucking things up for everyone.
Yeah, well, you know what? Too bad for them.
Fair enough. Like I say, that's only what happened in my living room.
Well, you just mentioned that one of them hadn't watched wrestling for a decade.
Yeah.
And I don't know how often the rest of them watch it, but that's not the audience that they were trying to attract with this finish.
This was absolutely insane live. Everybody hated Roman, except, oddly enough, the guy in front of me.
There were a couple of youngsters behind me that were big Roman fans, and I requested to be ejected from the building, but my pleas fell upon deaf ears.
Well, take it up with my son, because he's still a fan of Roman Reigns.
Hey, Roman Reigns got cheered at the SmackDown tapings.
I think Roman Reigns is a great professional wrestler. I think he's got a great look.
Define great.
Okay.
Roman?
I think he's a great package.
He's a good wrestler.
Good wrestler.
Great hair.
Awesome hair. Beautiful eyes. Come on now. And looking at the guy, he's perfect to be your world champ.
It's going to be an awesome song.
Okay. Unfortunately, fans don't like other wrestlers being shoved down their throat. And they revolted. And
this is a great recap of what's happened over the last year, Craig.
I'm just telling you. I'm just telling
you. We were there. We watched it all.
Continue.
I don't think. Is it the fact that they hate Roman, or is it the fact that they don't like people telling us what we should like?
It's a lot of things, Craig.
You know what I mean?
It's the big show. This guy was not ready to be the top guy.
Agreed.
He's not ready to be the top guy, and they did the anti-Paul Heyman. Did everything wrong with the guy. Guy ain't a great talker? Let's have him talk every week.
Right.
Guy can't have great matches? Let's have him feud with the fucking Big Show. Guy can't have great matches? Let's put him in the ring with Kane. People love Daniel Bryan? Let's have Roman Reigns beat Daniel Bryan. Did every possible fucking thing wrong.
Don't forget Seth Rollins pinned him.
And Seth Rollins pinned him. And the Big Show pinned him, mind you.
Yes.
This was their brilliant build to WrestleMania, and people shit all over it, as they say.
But it's not Roman's fault. It's the way that they pushed him.
That's what I just said. They did everything wrong with the guy.
Yeah, they did.
Yes, that's what I said. They did everything wrong with the guy. Roman is fine, but you know what? He's also not ready.
Agreed.
He's not a great worker. It's 2015, and people don't even want to see like a good worker, but they want to see like a great entertainer and a great performer.
Mm-hmm.
That is not Roman Reigns. God bless the guy, but he's like an action figure. They found an action figure and they're trying to make him into, you know what it is? It's Byron Saxton when he had to take over Raw last night.
Good God.
No.
No, it is. No. Byron Saxton is a good-looking guy. He's been doing commentary for a long time. He's
you can't
fine
tell.
At it.
No, he's not.
When he's in a three-man team, he's fine. But what do they do?
You
they
don't say.
They send this guy out on Raw all by him fucking self Monday night after WrestleMania, and he just sunk like a brick, exactly like Roman Reigns did. They're the same guy. That's the same situation in
no,
both
Roman
of those
on
cases.
His worst day was never as bad as Byron Saxton.
I haven't seen it yet.
Oh, my God.
But I heard all about it.
Oh,
but
my God.
The point is, it's the same situation. Why did they put that guy out there to do that? They thought it was going to be a good idea. Like, they thought it would be a great idea to feud Roman Reigns with the fucking Big Show and have him lose on television and cut shitty promos saying, suffer and suck it, Tash.
I did say that.
Yeah, he did. And you wonder why we ended up getting... He was going to win the title. Just so the world knows, Roman Reigns was going to win the title. I even think he was going to win the title all the way up till Sunday.
Probably until Brock signed.
Oh, after that. Even after Brock signed, he was still going to win.
What?
Well, Brock's not going to be on every show.
And then all of a sudden, that's I guess true. Vince just went, oh, holy shit, fuck, the guy's not over. And the rest is history. Anyway, that was WrestleMania. Hey, we've been bitching a little bit, but that was a great, that was the best live WrestleMania I've ever been to.
Yeah, totally.
One of the best live shows I've ever been to.
Easily.
One of the best WrestleManias of all time. That was a, to steal a sports term, a home run. Thank you, everybody. Let's play a song, then we'll do Raw, which was...
Just play the song.
Not a home run.
We've already gone more than an hour. Play the song.
Ah, calm down, dude.